Welcome, Kai. Everybody, this is at Kai Garney on Twitter. Kai, I'm going to let you give your own spiel, but ultimately you've got one of the coolest topics of the day for sessions, why I left Netflix to sell JPEGs on the internet. If that doesn't spark your interest, I don't know what will. For those that are sort of on Twitter and the Q&A on the Zoom, Kai will be taking questions at the end for about 5 or 10 minutes. So feel free to put those into the Q&A section of this webinar tool. Over to you, Kai. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. So I wanted to give a story about myself. I think this was a premise and obviously leading up to the fact that I've recently left Netflix and gone full-time into the world of NFTs. I know that's something that folks talk about and you know want to do. So I thought it'd be interesting to kind of say or to show my journey into the space. So let me just pull up a little presentation here. So I'm Kai. I'm currently a co-founder at BlockBlock, founder of Meebits DAO, and we launched Savage Droids. This is my story. So who am I and how did I get to be here today and why should you listen to me? I have a pretty varied background. I've worked in startups. I've worked kind of half of my time in the agency world. I've traveled a lot. So I started out in New York and California, where I went to Stanford and worked out of California in the beginning of my career. Then I went to London and spent 17 years in London, met my wife, and you know really settled over there for a time. Throughout, I was traveling a lot. And the reason why I say all this is because I think it's this background of sort of work experience and seeing people around the world and really wanting to understand how to engage with as an experienced designer, how to engage with different types of communities and perspectives that I think really kind of primed me for the world of NFTs and primed me for the community that lives around NFTs. And more recently, prior to coming back to the States and now I'm living in Los Angeles, I was working at a company called Moo. And there I was looking at the physical to digital experience. So we were Moo is a paper company, a card company, but I was leading up an innovation team around chips. So actually NFC chips inside of cards, where you can unlock different types of digital experiences from the physical world. So that had me thinking about tokenized experiences and how do you make things, how do you represent digital experiences in a physical kind of tokenized object like a business card. So then when I came to the States, I was working at Sony Pictures in video on demand. And on the side, I was kind of interested in still had this understanding of the tokenized digital experiences in my mind. And that's sort of what kind of primed me to get into that NFT space early on. So I'll get into that more, but I went from Sony Pictures, then I went to Netflix, and obviously I've left Netflix just this year within the last few months to join BlockBlock and do NFTs full time. So how did it all start? This is how it started. It started with CryptoKitties. And actually, skip the slide. It was a flu in the summer, in the winter of 2017 that led me to just be laid up in my bed online. I recently discovered crypto and did a deep dive on crypto. And then around November, CryptoKitties came along and I had nothing better to do. So I was just getting into this world of CryptoKitties and trying to understand it and buying and selling CryptoKitties when they launched. I think they were at ETH Denver, and that just sort of got the bug going, I suppose. And I saw, you know, it wasn't just about the cartoon cats. I immediately linked it back to what I had been doing before, and I saw, wow, this is a tokenized digital experience that you can collect, you can trade, you can, you know, you have a sense of digital ownership. So I really was excited about it. And then I also did a deep dive into, you know, how our CryptoKitties being bred. I thought that was really cool, and this unique way in which they were using the blockchain to, you know, to recombine the DNA code. And I just kind of, as you can see from these blog posts, I just kind of geeked out on it, and eventually cracked the code behind it and figured out what they were doing, and sort of used some of my, even though I've spent most of my career as a designer, I have a CS degree, so I kind of used that background to get into the bit, you know, kind of bit manipulation and, you know, decipher the code. So I kind of did that, and that was fun, and I enjoyed doing that. And I kind of put it off to one side and didn't really think about it very much. But that later came into play, because what I didn't realize is while I did that, there was a whole community that I was sort of involved in around CryptoKitties, but that was really digging into this blog post and really using that to understand how to breed and how to really make money from the CryptoKitties. And I think CryptoKitties was important in that a lot of the folks from that time used the lessons learned there to understand how NFTs work and how NFTs, how the NFT markets work. And CryptoKitties, you know, created the template for NFT contracts that most people are using now. So the ERC 721 contracts came out of that. And it really was a template, I think, for what was to come. So that was a really important community to be involved in. And I didn't realize that I was, you know, I just thought I was geeking out, you know, as I was away from my day job. But this turned out to be, I guess, important to the community to really understand how to breed and how to trade. And you know, it was kind of an important document for them. So that sort of played a role later on. Then while I was at Sony, I was really excited about the blockchain, and I was filing some patents, and I thought this is the future, and this is going to be the time when you know, I can bring Sony to the blockchain, and Sony can be doing NFTs, and we'll see NFTs on the PlayStation, and everything's happening. And you know, this is also the time when the crypto market was going crazy, and everyone was watching Bitcoin go insane, and it felt like, you know, this was a ride that was never going to stop. Except when it did. And, you know, following, as we moved into 2018, you know, we hit a big crypto bust period, and suddenly I found that all the interests, all the sponsors that I was warming up around various projects had gone cold. You know, crypto went from being something that you could get people in a room very excited about to, if you brought it up in a meeting, it was almost the butt of a joke. So that, you know, for me at least, 2018 was almost a write-off, in that I just realized that it wasn't going to be, you know, at Sony or at other places, it wasn't going to be the time for crypto to really hit mainstream, or for NFTs to hit mainstream. Which I found really frustrating, just knowing the potential. And I think seeing everyone involved now sees the same potential. But at the time, it just felt like everyone had abandoned it, from my perspective, at least in the corporate world. So that was frustrating. But I just sort of kept my ear to the ground. And I still had faith in the technology. And I felt like, right, we'll wait this out and we'll see where it goes. So then 2019... is an interesting period. So this kind of predates, I think, some people's involvement in NFTs. But what was actually going on is there was a lot of building. So for my personal story, I stayed in touch with Alan from the CryptoKitties time, and he joined Dapper and was kind of instrumental in building out CryptoKitties, the CryptoKitties community, and you know, getting involved in the mechanics of CryptoKitties as a NFT platform, and you know, how the mechanics of it work. So I stayed in touch with Alan throughout, and then there started to be some projects that were catching my attention. There was a project called Clovers that was doing something pretty cool. It was like using you know, figuring out a puzzle that was kind of like this kind of proof of work thing that was actually people doing the work of you know, figuring out all the different variations of a puzzle, of an Othello puzzle. And it was just really bizarre and off the wall and didn't make sense. And there were a lot of these projects going on. You know, I got involved later on with a project called Math that was just about, you know, adding numbers together on the blockchain. And then we realized, you know, the Alxo, who was behind it, we realized together that adding these things together, adding the numbers together, you're actually creating you know, a string of digits that could be represented as images. So you could actually create drawings out of this NFT that's just adding two numbers together. So I started to get back into the community, and I discovered all these folks that all the while had been, you know, a big part of the CryptoKitties community and sort of knew me from that earlier blog post. And they all just kind of welcomed me into the community and brought me up to speed on what had been going on for the past year that I kind of walked away from the space frustrated. And they, you know, these folks I remain friends with to this day, and we stay in touch. And, you know, only, and funnily enough, like only recently do I even know what some of them look like, what some of them sound like, but it's like, that's the weird world that we're in, that we know each other by each other's kind of avatars and pseudonyms. But yeah, these folks sort of got me back up to speed on what's going on in the world of crypto. And one person in particular, Jim, was working on a project. So I was also ranting online about, you know, hey, what happens to your image when the servers go down, and realizing that CryptoKitties aren't actually on chain. So it's like, isn't the whole promise of digital ownership that you own the data at the end of the day? So I was asking about that, and that's actually initially how Alan put me in touch with Jim, and Jim was also ranting around about similar things at the time. So then we got into the discussions in this community, got into the discussions of art on chain and how does art on chain work. And Jim had been working on a project called Avastars, and I got involved in that as an advisor and really did a deep dive on Avastars and got excited about what they were doing with putting SVGs on chain, so vector images on chain. And you know, that in a lot of ways predates a lot of what we're seeing now with the profile picture explosion. But, you know, Jim kind of set up this system that was doing randomly generated profile pics back then, and in some ways better than the systems we're seeing now, because it was, you know, stored on chain and had this amazing system. Going back to that project I mentioned before, Clovers, where you could just see all the generated avatars in front of you. So rather than just kind of hitting mint and seeing what you get, it's showing you a gallery of everything, and you could just choose the ones that you wanted, even though they're randomly generated. So he's doing a lot of innovative things that I really got excited about with this whole art on chain movement. But also with art on chain, there was a Eric Calderon Snowfro on Twitter launched a platform called Artblocks. So that I found really interesting. And this was a platform for people to write generative code and put that on chain, and it would create art out of it. So something else that had been going on in my life in parallel is I'd always been doing generative art just as something that didn't really need to see the light of day, but it was just something to blow off steam. And you know, this is something I did just as an experiment while I was working in game design, and I wanted to explore these different patterns that reminded me of the graphics of my youth, and that you had a limited number of colors and you put them together and they created all these different patterns. So I just worked that up as a project, and I did these kind of generative art projects mostly for myself. But then Artblocks came along, and I thought, oh, I can put this on the Artblocks, and you know, if no one else likes it, at least it's fun for me to do. But this turned into a project called 27-Bit Digital, which to my surprise at the time, just, you know, was one of the early Artblocks projects and sold out. And I found that very exciting. And sort of now I was in this world where, you know, I'm with these other generative artists, and I'm sort of seeing myself not just as a designer, but as an artist. And from there, I did a few more projects. I did a project called Pixel Glass. And that was in tandem with 27-Bit Digital. I let people redeem the Pixel Glass for a glass print of the 27-Bit Digital project. So again, exploring this kind of physical, the digital side of things. And yeah, so this is an example of how the glass prints turned out when I sent them to people. I worked on some other projects. So this was a collective carve or a project with artists. And Excess Bits was a follow-up project I made based on the original project. So 27-Bit Digital used a random number, and this used the same random number, but generated a different piece of art. So it's kind of linked to the original project. And then, I don't know if this will come up, this will come through audio-wise, but I worked on I started doing collaborations. So there was a collaboration with an artist, CJ Carr, where we did these byte beats and did generative music on-chain. So this is a precursor to where we are now, but this is an early collaboration with Savage Dogs. And I'll just skip through some of these, but these are all, what excited me about getting involved with collabs is that I got to work with different artists and got to work with my friends and, you know, we knocked ideas back and forth and came up with something completely new involving each of our styles. So something else I did in parallel was as an NFT artist and as a Black NFT artist, I was looking around and, you know, trying to figure out where the other Black NFT artists were, knowing that they exist. But I did a campaign where I called it, during Black History Month, I called it Black NFT Month. And each day, I started midway through the month, but each day of the month, I went out and I tried to discover a new Black NFT artist and bought their work. And through that process, I found a few artists who went on to be much bigger. And I think the lesson there is, it's always worthwhile to seek out up-and-coming artists and to seek out artists from underrepresented communities and LGBTQ and, you know, women artists. And I think, you know, if you look for artists that you just enjoy their work, then that's a reward in itself. But also, you might hit on, you know, artists that are up and coming. And some of the artists that I found here, you know, these were some of their early works, and they've gone on to do amazing things. So I think it's, you know, the lesson I learned there. I hadn't done as much outside of collectibles, and I was a little bit confused about how to go about buying art or who should I buy art from. Thinking about it from a collectible standpoint, but I realized that you just have to go for kind of what the art that resonates with you, and that's the right art to buy. So then earlier this year, Mebits was a project by Larva Labs, the makers of CryptoPunks, and it came out and captured the attention of a lot of people in the space because they made a 3D NFT avatar where you could download the avatar, and they put out the challenge, I guess, to the community that, you know, use these to build the metaverse. So there was this open-ended challenge that really it was exciting, and everyone was excited that Larva Labs was doing this. Also that they were doing something that spoke to building the metaverse and having more utility from your NFT than just something that you would collect and look at. But there wasn't like an immediate roadmap or immediate next step. So we started thinking, well, what if we create a Mebits DAO because we were also interested in the DAO space and understanding how do DAOs work and these types of organizations that are meant to be decentralized, but you know, people were talking a lot about, but we didn't see any in action. So this was one of the first projects I did with as an advisor to BlockBlock, where we were asking the question, like, how do we learn what DAOs are doing? Probably the best way to find out is to try to build one ourselves. And then Mebits came along, and it seemed like a really nice pairing where we could say, well, why not try to build a DAO around Mebits, where the community could try to build the future of the metaverse, and build the building blocks of the metaverse, as we say, based on the Mebit as the starting point. So, you know, give utility to your Mebits, see if we could get Mebits into all the virtual worlds, and what can we do with it. So we started creating this community and just put it out there. And we're surprised at how you know, the feedback and how much support we got for the idea. And when we launched the founders and brought the founders in and opened up the treasury to the founders, we raised $500,000 in ETH. And for me, that was the first proof point of, you know, wow, this is something that I enjoy. This is something on the side, but there's also real interest. There's also a real sort of viable model for doing things, for fundraising around a project, for fundraising around the business. So this was, I guess, the first proof point while I was at Netflix, but advising BlockBlock that kind of tipped me in the direction of, you know, maybe there's something here that I could do full time. So that brings us up to date with BlockBlock. So BlockBlock was the company that I was advising. So that it consists of currently two co-founders with myself, Bart DeCrem and Mark Mayo, both kind of veteran industry entrepreneurs and folks that have done this time and again successfully. So that again made it easier for me to take the leap. But really it was us starting to build things together and feeling like we were having some success and just seeing the space. And together, you know, I brought what I had been doing at Netflix to the mix, where originally BlockBlock was kind of maybe an open-ended blockchain lab. Together, we got this focus around building franchise IP for the metaverse. And one of the first projects that we've launched with that focus is Savage Droid. So again, working with the artist that I mentioned prior, Martin Beckerman, who had been doing Savage Dogs, and had this bigger picture of a story world and a story and a narrative universe that is in his, you know, he'd started to portray through his NFTs. We thought that could be a good starting point for us to explore this idea of franchise IP for the metaverse. And what we mean by franchise IP for the metaverse is this seems to be the what people are looking for. So when people buy a Bored Ape or, you know, a Mebit or a CryptoKitty maybe, it seems like people are expecting there's, you know, what more will come for it? Maybe a game, maybe something more. But when people say things like, oh, wouldn't it be great if a Bored Ape made an appearance in the Super Bowl commercial or something along the lines of that, it sounds like the community is really looking for these collectibles to find a new life in, whether it's television or movies or whether it's games. Coming from my perspective, coming out of Netflix, that to me speaks to franchise IP. So it's if we're in a world where you know, people are experimenting with and creating new characters and new narratives and new story worlds, with BlockBlock, we want to say, well, what if we use our background, you know, me from Netflix, Bart with a history in you know, from Disney and launching some of the number one apps on the App Store, and Mark with his technical expertise and having launched big open source projects at Mozilla. It's like, together we feel like we could approach this in a way that is unique and can really, you know, think about how you launch a franchise in a way that's more than just a roadmap. Like, how do you actually do this? How do you actually connect the dots from a collectible through to something that exists in media? So that's kind of our thesis for the company, and that's something we're excited to get started on the journey of. And it was a big enough opportunity for me to take the leap from Netflix and to do this full time.
Very fascinating, Kai. Thank you so much. We've had a lot of questions come in, and we may not get all to all of them right now, but I'll give you a couple of the top ones that I've seen, and then maybe anyone else that doesn't have their question answered might like to reach out to you on Twitter, potentially at Kai Garney. So starting off with from Chi, she says, hi Kai, why do you think Meebits is not getting the same love and attention as the Punks, considering they're both created by Lava Labs? I'm sure you've had that question quite a bit over the journey.
Yeah, sure. So I don't know that. I mean, that can be interpreted in different ways. I don't know why that it's not getting the same love and attention as Punks. I think it's earlier in its journey than Punks. You know, so going back through the story I told, when I came back from the NFT winter, I was looking at Punks, and I you know, Punks were going for like 1, 2, 3 ETH, and I didn't really think much about them. I know that the community I was in was sort of going wild about them, but that seemed kind of strange and expensive. And you know, that was an opportunity that, you know, before Punks were Punks. So I think, you know, you could be looking back at Meebits in 5 years and see the same situation where, you know, they're well above floor. So I don't think it's that they've been neglected by the community or that they've been forgotten about. I think it's just early in their life, and it's early in their, you know, if we're imagining they're going to be this avatar from the metaverse, you know, the metaverse isn't even built out in a form that you can have an avatar running around in the way that I think we imagine we would like. So I don't know if that's a...
Yeah, I think the floor price is done quite well in the last sort of couple of months, even for me. But this one from Jake. Hi, Kai. What have been your favorite NFT project gamification strategies so far?
So that's an interesting one. I mean, I think it's tricky. So I spent a lot of time in the blockchain game space. Like I played, you know, Crypto Space Commanders and some other ones. And what I found is that what's hard is that if you approach a game in some ways that you just sort of add an NFT into them, it can kind of ruin the fun in that you get the communities playing either a grinding mechanic where they're just trying to get the value out of the token that's being generated, or they're trying to play in a way that they get the higher value. I mean, it's like the market forces can effectively corrupt the fun of the game. So I kind of think that the NFT aspect of it, you know, this is just my thinking, I don't know if it's true or not, is that I think the NFT aspect of it has to be orthogonal to the gameplay, in that if there are, you know, there are ways in which you can decorate your characters, or ways in which you can sort of collect things, and you know, things that award, you know, rewards and trophies that come out of it that are kind of badging, and maybe they're unlockables, maybe they're things that fall out of the game and mean something to a DAO. So I think they could be part of a broader ecosystem, but I think when you make the game economy central to the, or the crypto economy central to the game, I haven't really seen, I know maybe some people will say Axies, I haven't really seen an example of that works for me as a model.
Yeah. Last question, Kai. What are the recommended tools in your view to create awesome NFTs? That's a broad question, but is there any one or two resources that you would point people to?
NFT creation. Well, as an advisor to NFT 42 and Nameless, I would say, you know, wait for Nameless to launch their platform. They're launching an NFT platform. But for the most part, we've been doing things working directly with developers and building the platform out. So I know that's not an easy route to go because it's hard to find developers, but there are, you know, if given a developer, there are set patterns for, you know, there's standards for these things now that it's fairly well known, and there's not a lot of sort of building from scratch risk if you're doing something that's fairly conventional. So I still kind of steer people down the path of, you know, find a way to do your own contract and to get a contract made for your NFT rather than going to the platforms that will just, you know, use a kind of collective contract. But there are a few minting sites out there now. I've always been looking for, I'm still kind of looking for the lazy minting platform where you can just upload your assets and you know, the buyer will mint and pay the gas as they're minting them. But I think we're still early days and you know, there's not a great answer to that, I don't think.
No worries. Well, thanks again, Kai. Where can people find you other than Twitter? Do you want to point them in any direction if they want to learn about MeBitsDAO and any other projects that you're leading?
Yeah, I mean, Twitter is the best place to reach me, at Kaigani, as you see in the corner of my screen over there on the Medium. I mean, Medium, I've been showing some of the Medium posts throughout, so I always post Medium. At MeBitsDAO for MeBitsDAO, and that's going to be opening up for general membership soon, so that's something to look out for. But yeah, I would say primarily Twitter, and I would say Discord, but because of MeBitsDAO, I can't even see friend requests now, so Twitter is probably the best way to reach me.
No worries. Well, thanks again, Kai, for being involved in NFT Fest Australia. Really appreciate the time. I know it's in the evening there for you in the US.